Let's just spend a moment. Let's lift up the name of Jesus. We exalt you. We worship you. We glorify you. Hallelujah. Praise you, God. I didn't get up here and want to do that. That wasn't part of my plan, but I just kind of feel like there's something special about today. God's in the place. And we've got to remember, I think when we come to church, we have to remember that we did not come for a consumer experience. We are a participatory church. Say that 10 times real quick. Participatory, participatory. It's a hard word to say, but we come to participate. We come to give God everything. Hey, why don't you take your seats? We are going to get into this today. It's going to be awesome. For anybody who is in the place today, who has always wanted to sit down near the front but never got here in time, now is your opportunity. There is some seats in the second and third row. You're trying to tell me, I know, Kim, that's a seat for Kim. Kim, we've got a seat for you over here. Kim, great job this morning, worship team. They did fantastic. So good. Everyone breathe. I don't know what's going to happen this morning. I've got an excitement. I was ready to preach. I was telling Cynthia before, I was ready to preach at 9 o'clock, ready to go. Fired up, pumped up, ready to go. And I don't know what's going to happen, but we're going to go for it this morning. So can you come with me? Can we go somewhere together? I don't want to just get up. I'm sick of getting up and just speaking to people who, you know, just want to just, oh, I'm going to listen. No, I want you to come on a journey with us. We've actually been going on a journey this whole year. Have we been going on a journey? And whether you've noticed it or maybe you haven't noticed it, maybe it's sort of been sort of hidden from you, but we've been going on a journey. We've been looking at all of the depth of what it means to have a rock solid faith, to have a Christianity that is so deep in God that we actually become mature in Him, that we can help and influence other people as well. So that's been our goal, and we've walked through basically what does it mean to understand and have an understanding of God, and what is an understanding of Jesus, and what's an understanding of the Bible, an understanding of the Holy Spirit. And now over the last probably 5 weeks, this is week number 5, we've been looking at what does it mean to be a part of the church. And Rachel did a fantastic job last week. While I was up in Neil, great job. Talking about the generosity of the early church and how they gave their time, their talent, and their treasure towards what was going on in the church. They sowed so generously. And previous to that, we've been looking at the who and the what is the church. The church is not a place, it's a... I think you could do that. We'll try that one more time. The church is not a place, it's a...
People.
And the church is more than a people, it's a...
It's
a place. That's right. It's one of those conundrums because it's both. We are not just a place, we are a people, but we're more than just a people, we are a place. When the church gathers together physically in proximity with one another, something powerful happens. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there, he says. So we've been looking at a few different things. We looked at whose is the church and how the church and Christ are inseparable at the center of everything. We always kind of think of as Christians, oh, isn't just I just have to have Christ in the middle. Well, to have Christ in the middle without the church in the middle kind of means you're missing something kind of major from that. The church is Christ's body. And he has placed it at the center. He is at the head of all things. So he can't separate the two things. We've got this marriage that's gone on between Christ and the church. It's his body. It's his bride. And to not have the church in the center would be kind of like, and I've said this before, and I know it's kind of funny, but be coming up to me and saying, hey, Pastor Andrew, I want to be your best friend in the whole world. We're going to do life together. But can we just not hang out with Rachel? Because, you know, she's kind of mean sometimes. We all know this is not true, right? Rachel's not mean, she's beautiful. But I'm paying the example. And that's kind of like saying, oh, Jesus, I want to be really close to you. I want to have such a great relationship with you. I want to be in your presence. I want to experience you. But you know what? I just can't stand the church. It's the same picture. And we can't do that. So I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about what I want to call profitable Christianity. Profitable, I think it's going to come up on the screen here at some stage, maybe. There it goes. Profitable Christianity. And no, I'm not meaning profitable as in what can I get out of it. But we're going to go over the next couple of weeks, we're going to look at what does it mean to have a Christianity that is profitable to our soul? 1 Corinthians 12:27-31, this has kind of been at the basis of what we've been talking about. It says, now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you still a more excellent way. Come on, let's pray. Father, we commit this time to you that we would get around your word and let it soak into us, that we are changed from the inside out. Father, this morning we open up our hearts to gaining even more understanding and perspective of what does it mean to be your church. And we pray that you would speak to us in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen, amen. Amen. So what does it mean to belong to the church? Being part of the church is more than just joining a club. If you wanted to just join a club, there's plenty of clubs around town that you could go and join. And I'm not going to make recommendations because some of you probably will go and join one of those clubs. But it's part of being the body. You know, you're a limb. You're a body part. You're a part of this thing. And that body part cannot function outside of itself. It doesn't work. An arm, if you just put an arm, I'm going to take my arm off and I'm going to put it over here. It doesn't work by itself. It needs to be connected to something else to actually have life. And that's why we are the church. The church exists that way, in that manner, that we are all connected to each other and therefore have our life and our sustenance. We're a part of the whole. We are not out on our own. And as a Christian, as a believer, you can't stand by yourself. Like it or not, you need the church. And like it or not, the church needs you. Even the ones that are sometimes like sandpaper. Everybody knows that person. Don't look at them. Everybody knows that guy. Don't elbow. It's not. But occasionally we meet people who rub us up the wrong way. Sometimes they're actually rubbing things off us that need to come off. Rough edges and all sorts of things. But we can't stand alone. And what we're actually really talking about here is this word called discipleship. And we talked about this right from the very beginning of this year. We started a message and I spoke on the topic of come follow me, where Jesus was walking by the seashore and he saw some fishermen that he had no prior relationship to at all. He met people he did not have a personal connection with, that people that would not have known who he was from a bar of soap. They didn't have Instagram or social media. They didn't have the newspaper. They didn't have the TV media. They didn't go, oh, hey, there's this guy called Jesus and he's walking around looking for people. There was no advertising campaign looking for new apprentices. Jesus just walked up to these guys who were doing something else and said, come follow me. And you know what the strangest thing is? They did. I'm like, just picture yourself in that situation for a second. Like, just say, for instance, I'm sitting here, Nathan's over here, and he's fishing. He's sitting there, and he's just fishing. And I just walk past him, and he's never met me before, and I just go, hey, come follow me. He's going to go, stranger danger. I don't know you. I'm not going with you anywhere. But we see this picture, this thing that when Jesus called, the disciples followed. They didn't even know where. He didn't say, hey, come follow me. We're going to go and do this and do that. And this is the thing. Then we're going to here and there. And you're going to learn this and you're going to learn that. No. He just said, come follow me. And they did. They just did. The discipleship, completely following after Jesus, is the only way for us to live. We've got to walk back into this. There's one key word that is engaged throughout Scripture in reference to discipleship. And that is this word that we hate as people. And it's this word, obedience. Discipleship is obedience. Obedience is super comfortable, right? It's easy. You just do it. You just like, you hear something, oh, that's easy, I'll just do it. No, obedience is tough because it requires us to actually lay down our priorities and pick up something else. To actually lay down ourselves and pick up Jesus. To obediently follow Jesus' teaching and examples. Discipleship is the process of devoting oneself to a teacher to learn and become more like them. For the Christian, this refers to the process of learning the teachings of Jesus and following after his example in obedience through the power of the Holy Spirit. Discipleship not only involves the process of becoming a disciple, but of making other disciples. A true disciple of Jesus is not just here for you, you're here for everybody else as well. I was reading this week, and I've got a couple of words that I'm going to absolutely butcher. So for the Greek speakers in the room, please don't judge me. And we'll try to get here. But discipleship in the Old Testament is fundamentally about learning what is required from the Torah, that's the first five books of the Bible, and submitting to that in obedience. That was the discipleship process in the Old Testament. So for any young Jewish boy growing up, they would have to learn and off by heart be able to memorize and speak back the first five books of the Bible. That sounds like a good time. I mean, I'm thinking about Leviticus. I'm like going, man, I've struggled just to even read some like through that. It's like if you're trying to read through a Bible reading plan and you're going, right, Genesis, Exodus. All right, brace yourself. Leviticus is coming. But the terms, the Hebrew terms, yassar and lamad, mean to instruct and to teach. And they fit this idea of discipleship really well, as they both strongly imply a change in behavior as a result of this instruction. There's a change in behavior. You're not just learning knowledge here. You're not just going, well, I'm going to learn about God. I want to know everything. But by learning about God, you actually start to become more like Him. You start to become more like Jesus. And it's the same thing in the New Testament. There's two words, methetes. I'm just getting an approval over here. Methetes, which means disciple. And the other word, methano, which means, did I say this? Did I pronounce that okay? Methano. I kind of sounded like. Yes, methano. I kind of sounded a little bit like the guy from, you know, My Big Fat Greek Wedding. Give me a word, any word, and I'll show you that the root of that word is Greek. Kimono. No, sorry. Come from the Greek word kimona, meaning robe. Sorry. I love those movies. They're fun. It's a good one. It's a good one. All right. But the root word meaning of matano is to learn, which means it ties discipleship with learning in a structure. Like the Hebrew terms, however, these words refer not only to the transfer of information, but also the transformation of one's lifestyle to become more like the teacher. So matano, when it's used in this biblical context, it's learning, it's growing, it's expanding yourself, but in the process you are being transformed. You're being changed from the inside out. And this is this process of discipleship. So to accept the call to come and follow Jesus is to lay down your life in the obedience to the one who gave his life for you. And this is what we do as a part of the church. Jesus wants us to follow him, but what does that really look like? You're like, okay, yes, I get this, Pastor Andrew. You've been talking about the church. You've been talking about all of this stuff. And how do we actually do it? How do we be the church? When it comes to the church and belonging, which I believe that you can't separate discipleship from, right? I want to explain this. I want to make sure that this is really clear. If you belong to the church, you are putting your hand up for becoming a disciple. If you are a disciple, you are putting your hand, if you claim to be a disciple, you have put your hand up to belong to the church. Yeah. There's this emphasis on belonging in all of this. We belong to the church and the church belongs to us. We are part of the body. We can't be pulled out and separated. Have we got that yet after 5 weeks? Yeah. Are we understanding so far? We can't be, that if we are in Christ, he is in us, we are in the church, we are all, it's all tied together. And this is the biggest thing in church, is that you might preach a really good message 1 week on this and explains it really well, but not everyone was here, or not everyone was watching. So we got to repeat things. So that's why you find pastors often repeat things. And I want to sit on this. I want us to emphasize and get it. We've got to get this in our heart, is that the church is at the center. When it comes to the church and belonging to the church, I think we can find some definite things that we need to know on the way in. We need to have an understanding of is that what we're actually getting ourselves in for. There are two things that we need to be aware of when we come into the church. One, there are benefits. There are benefits to being in the church. There are rich rewards. There are things that are we could not get anywhere else. We are rewarded for being a part of the church. Now comes the fun part. There's also this thing called responsibility. How many teenagers love responsibility? Jaden, you are a very responsible young man. You are. But there are benefits and responsibilities. Let's look at it this way. In a family, you have this progression. You have this starting point in a family, and then you go all the way through life, and there's different modes and roles within a family, right? Not everybody has the same function and role. Not just like in Corinthians, not all are apostles, not all are prophets, not all are teachers. But in a family, you come into the family as a baby, as a child. Now, we have a look at a child, have a look at a baby, for example. A baby doesn't really have any responsibility, but it's all benefit. What are the responsibilities of a baby? Cry, poop, eat, sleep, repeat. I mean, it's not really a responsibility. That's the benefits. You get everything done for you. You get fed. You get changed. You get washed. You get cleaned. You get looked after. You get cuddled. You get nurtured. Everything is done for you as a baby. But some of the responsibilities that maybe you'd like to have later on in life, you don't have available to you right now. Like, for example, you don't give a baby the TV remote and say, choose what channel you want to watch. Babies don't have control over the remote control. They don't get to choose what we're watching. They don't get to pick that stuff. They get it picked for them. They also don't get to choose what they wear. Every parent kind of goes through that phase where it's like, when it's actually a really gratifying scenario when children decide that they're going to start to dress themselves and choose what they wear. Now, color coordination is not always natural in some certain circumstances. But how good is it when you don't have to go, oh, I've got to pick out my own outfit, and I've got to pick out someone else's outfit as well, and I've got to make sure that they get dressed. How good is it when kids can actually start to dress themselves? So as a baby, you've got nothing. But as a child, you've got some limited responsibilities, but increasing benefits, it changes. You know what? You might get the responsibility of actually choosing what's on TV as a child. You might get the responsibility of maybe once in a while getting to choose what you're having for dinner. Mum might say, hey, what do you want for dinner this week? Oh, I'd like to have spaghetti. And they go, all right, well, I'll make spaghetti. You get the choice of that. But as a baby, you don't get the same choice. So as you can see the picture here, as a child, your benefits start to grow. You get a little bit more ownership, but you also get a little bit more responsibility. And then teenagers don't want any responsibility. They just want all the benefit. Yeah. Tell me I'm wrong. Every teenager's like going, But the benefits might include becoming a teenager is that you might get to stay up a little bit later. You know, you understand a little bit more about the family structure. You start to learn a little bit more about what does it mean to be a part of the family. You might be able to input into some family decisions. Like maybe, for instance, where are we going to go on holiday this year? And every teenager is like, oh, we're going to Disneyland. Now, you don't have to pay for it, but you get input into the decision-making process. You start to get your voice heard. You start to grow in the family. You start to understand a little bit more about how it all works. But again, as your benefits grow, so do your responsibilities grow. You might be expected to care for siblings or, you know, babysit when mum and dad want to go on date night. Every parent said, hallelujah, for date night. You know, you might have to cook meals occasionally or do the laundry or do some chores or maybe even get a job to start earning your own cash so that you're not a burden on the remaining family budget. These are some of the growth. So benefits rise, but also responsibilities rise. And it's also a fight to get the TV remote out of their hands or to get them off their phone or off an iPad or out of their room to socialize with anybody. Then you come to maybe a young adult. A young adult has even more benefits again. You go out, you set your own schedule, you don't have all of the different responsibilities of maybe being in the family and doing things. You decide what to eat. Problem is, you might also decide that, I'm going to move out, I'm going to get my own place. You decide what you want to eat. The problem is that you're going to have to cook it. You're going to have to clean up after yourself. You're going to have to start to, look at you. You've got all of these extra benefits. You're going, well, maybe I'm going to start a romance. Awesome. You start to go, whoa, hang on. There's some benefits starting a romance and responsibility. Very good. But then there's this new thing that gets introduced when you become a young adult. It's this thing called a bill. Oh. And you are responsible for paying the bills. If you start to move out, you've got to pay the rent, you've got to pay the electricity, you've got to pay the water, you've got to pay the gas, you've got to pay the internet, you've got to pay the phone, you've got to pay. And it ends up being this cycle of growth in benefit, growth in responsibility. Could I get a bottle of water? Excuse me, everybody in Nil. They would have heard that louder than here. Oh, thank you, Nathan. That was expertly done. Is this sparkling? It's for you, Ryan. I would have sparkling for Ryan Emerson. Ah, very good. Awesome. But then when you become an actual adult, right? A young adult into an adult, even more benefit, even more responsibility. You might go, I'm going to enter into a marriage. I'm going to find the woman of my dreams and go into marriage. And it's a whole nother level of benefit and responsibility. You have this thing that's introduced into your life called, well, let's just call it intimacy. It's a whole range of another benefit, but it comes with a whole lot of more responsibility. You have to share your life now with somebody else. You are responsible for that person, for their growth, for their outcomes. You are not just looking after you, but you've taken on the responsibility of somebody else. You can't just go through life and go, well, I just want to increase in benefits. An increase in benefits comes with an increase in responsibility. And then you've got this next stage, and it's not the final stage, it's the next stage. It's called the responsibility and the benefit of becoming a parent. This is different. This is the game changer. This is where everything in life changes. You are now caring completely for someone who cannot do a single thing back to help you, except bring you joy. When you take on a baby, when you've got a baby, that baby can't do anything for you apart from make you smile and make your heart warm. But you have to do everything for that baby. So there's another cycle here. There's a new level of benefit, a new level of responsibility. The benefits of this stage of life are not comparable with the other stages of life. But the responsibilities of being a parent seem to outweigh everything else. It's more responsibility, and sometimes it feels like, oh man, the benefits here are not on par. The responsibilities are right up here, and that's the responsibility of being a parent in this situation. Not only are you responsible for yourself, you're now responsible for others, not just your spouse, but also your children, your offspring. And then you have this next stage, and I like to call this the grandparent stage. Maximum benefit, minimum responsibility. You can have the kids and have lots of fun, but when they start to cry, you go, here you go, give them back. You get the joy of having grandchildren. You get to spoil them rotten. You get to give them sugar and gifts. And then when they start to turn feral, you're going, off you go, back to mum and dad. But we have this increasing scale. And you can see the picture I'm trying to build here was that when we come into the church, we come in at the base level. We have benefit and not much responsibility at all. And then as we grow, actually the benefits grow of being in the church. But then also there's responsibilities. And it keeps growing and it keeps growing. And I'm telling you this, is that you don't reach the grandparent stage of being a Christian. That's heaven. That's when you graduate to glory. So you got to understand that coming into this, there is a, yes, there are benefits to that, but there's also responsibilities. And today, I just want to focus in the short time that we've got left on the benefits of being a believer. Rachel preached a brilliant message on the difference between owning and renting. And I'm going to share that this week in the newsletter. I think we need to revisit that. There's a difference between being an owner and a renter when it comes to the house of God. Renters versus owners have different levels of responsibility and ownership. But the owner is responsible and gets the house and gets the capital growth. They get the increase. They don't have to clean the house all the time. But so there's different levels of benefit and growth. The renter doesn't get the capital growth, but they get the benefit of living there. But the owner has a different level of responsibility. And for us as in the house, we are called to be owners, not renters. A renter just comes into the church and puts their feet up and goes, serve me.
Yeah, that's right.
No, we come to church to serve God, not to be served. That's our level of responsibility. Paul writes in Romans some interesting things in language about what we belong to. He uses this term called members. Romans 6:13, do not present your members as to sin, as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. Now, he's talking here in a personal sense, like your members, your bodily parts, your functions, the things that you do are your members. And then he says in 6:19, I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations, for just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity, sin, and lawlessness leading to more lawlessness, now present your members as slaves to righteousness leading to sanctification. He's talking here, and I want to really paint a picture. The members are not self-governing, but they execute the orders of our mind. My hand doesn't just go, well, I'm going to go and do that and then do it, unless I actually have some kind of dysfunction, right? I'm not being critical to people who cannot control their functions, but that's generally what happens. My hand, I think my hand to go that way, and my hand will go that way, right? This is how it works. It doesn't just go, well, I'm going to go that way. No, we serve as function of the mind, that executes the order of the mind, obeying either the lower nature in the commission of the sin or iniquity, unrighteousness or uncleanness. Now, Paul here, he's speaking about this concept in two different ways. He's saying you need to control yourself. Make sure that your hand doesn't sin, and if it does sin, then cut it off, is what he does say. That's a bit harsh. But he's also speaking as far as members as part of one body. He's speaking individually and corporately. We need to control our members. We need to control the way that we do things. We are part of one body. And as a body, we need to act as a body. Not just keep going, oh, I'm just going to run over here and do that. No, we're actually part of the whole, part of the one. We can't split the term members into this sense for being a physical part of our body, but we're also part of the body of Christ. And it's about acknowledging that we are not in this alone. I need to move on. We're running out of time. I get in trouble for saying that. So I'm going to draw more attention to the fact that I just said it. Error 101. Stop talking about the time. Okay. All right. So what are the benefits? Here I've got six benefits really, really quickly. The first benefit is this of actually belonging to the church, is that you discover who you are in Christ. You discover who you are. We're all individuals. We're unique. But there are things that we now share as members of the body. It says in Ephesians 2, verse 19, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens. Gee, that's encouraging. I should have said no longer strange aliens. But you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. There's that word again, members. Romans 12:5. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We are together, we're joined. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. We have a sheet here, and I've got a whole bunch of people who want to find out what their identity in Christ is. I've got a whole bunch of these sheets sitting out on the information desk, and it's just literally scripture after scripture after scripture telling you who you are in Jesus. This is the place where you find out who you are. You can't find out who you are when you're outside of the body. It's only when you're in the body. Is that making sense? Good. The second thing is, one of the benefits of belonging to the church is that you are supported by others. This is a family. And we do things together as a family. When things get tough, we're here for each other. When things are good, we celebrate with each other. This is why we have pastoral care. This is why we have our prayer chain. It's why we have the different departments in the church. It's why we have connect groups. It's why we have teams. It's why we have courses and classes, because we support each other. We're here for each other. We're in this together. Ephesians 2:21 says, "In whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you are also being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit." We are growing into something together. It's together. It's not separate. We are together. We're growing within the body of Christ, and we support each other in that. We support each other. You know, support also means being accountable to one another. We often think that, hey, if the church is here to support me, it's kind of one way. You got to support me when I'm having a tough time. But we kind of get a little bit of an imbalance when it comes to somebody else having a tough time. I said, oh, that's too bad. I'm sorry that they're feeling like that. I'm sorry that that's happening in your situation. But support goes both ways. But support in the church context also means being accountable to one another. For when one person falls down in sin, we're there to challenge, correct, help, guide, and build back up and lift them up. Support means being accountable. It means being able to be confronted. It means being able to be challenged. It means being able to be open enough and a part of the body enough to have someone come to you in love and help to pick you back up again. Galatians 6:1-2 says, "Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him to a spirit in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." This is support. This is support. I love that thought that we bear each other's burdens. So when someone else is falling off the rails, we actually go and help them and support them to bring them back into right relationship with God. The third thing, if you're writing down notes, which you should be, if you're not, I'll test you later, is that you find your unique value as being a part of the church. You find your unique value. We're not all the same. Like I've said over and over again, unity is not uniformity. It's actually working together. The little finger is different from the thumb. They're different. I mean, this one's short and fat, and this one's kind of long and skinny. They're not the same. They both have a function. They're both very helpful. They work in different ways together, but they're different. And we have our uniqueness, and we find out our uniqueness as being a part of the body of Christ. Romans 12:4-5, "For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one in body in Christ and individually members one of another." We've got our own personalities and the way we respond. And I think Rachel flagged this last week, that we're going to, in the next little while, we're going to release a spiritual gifts test. We would love everybody in the church to be a part of that, to help find where your unique place is in the church, because we all have a unique place. The fourth thing, I've got to move. You receive protection as being a part of the church. Psalm 100 verse 3 says, "Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pastor." His pastor. Hey, pastor just means shepherd, really. "And a shepherd protects the flock." There is protection in the house. There is spiritual covering in the house. When you go out and you say, "Well, I'm going to follow Jesus and I'm going to do it all by myself and I don't need the church," you know what you've got? Nothing. You don't have any spiritual covering. You don't have any oversight. You don't have any accountability. You don't have any responsibility. All you want is all the benefit and none of the other stuff. Yeah. And that's called selfish Christianity. Because the church is a body and we are together. Hebrews 13 verse 17. And this is my favorite scripture right now. "Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls, as those who will give have to give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you. Let me translate that last phrase for you just really quickly. Don't be a pain in the pastor's bum. It's the Andrew Standard Version. Just joking. But you have to give an account, and I have to give an account for the way that I shepherd you. This is my responsibility. The job of the pastor is to lead and protect the flock. That is my role. There's a story. I don't know. You know what? I'm making time because this is important. There's a young. Everybody knows that we came from Hillsong. This is our fourth year being here now. We're into our fourth year. But we actually came out of Hillsong, and we had a testimony from one of the guys who used to be and is part of the worship team up there, and his name is Taleli. Taleli Feletolo. He is an islander guy, and he was an amazing singer and worship leader, and he fell out of the house because stuff got hard in his life. And the testimony that he started to come back into church, someone grabbed him and put their arm around him and guided him and led him back into fellowship. And his testimony was this, is that I was struggling. I fell away from God. I fell away from everything. And he said this one thing that has never left me. He said, it's better to struggle in the house where there's hope and where there's help than to try and struggle alone. Yes. And for somebody here today, maybe you're on the fence, or maybe you're listening at home, or you're watching up there. It's better to struggle in the house, in the body of Christ, where someone can help you and guide you and pick you up and put their arm around your shoulder and lead you into all righteousness in Christ, than it is to try and do it by yourself. There is help here. There is protection here. Is this the last thing? No. That's one of the things anyway. You become productive. I'm going to talk about that next time. You become productive. You know what? You can't become productive for Christ without connection to the church. It's trying to do it all in your own strength. You need the church. You need Christ. It's one and the same. Georgia, do you want to come? I'm going to wrap this up. We have a community of hope in the church. This is one of the benefits of being in the church, is that we have a community of hope. It says in Hebrews 6:19, it says we have this hope as an anchor, a sure and steadfast anchor for the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain. In the church community, there's hope, there's life, there's faith. There's the presence of God. We come together and we find all of these things mashed together in this community that we call the church. There's hope here. There is a rock on which we are anchored to, and that is Christ the Lord. We are built on that rock. Interesting enough, I love this story in the book of Matthew. Jesus is talking to Peter, and he said in verse 15 of chapter 16, he says, but who do you say that I am? Because everyone had been asking, you know, like saying, oh, all these people have been saying this about you, and all these people have been saying that about you. You're a prophet, you're Elijah, you're this, you're that. Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter says that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon bar Jonah, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Now, some people sort of think that, okay, on Peter, Petros means rock. Jesus is building the church on Peter. He's the base and the foundation of the church. No. The foundation and the base on the church is a revelation that Jesus Christ is the Lord. That is the foundation, and that is the rock on which Jesus said, I will build my church, is on that revelation and that revelation alone. It's on Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's the foundation, and we are the house that is built on that. And in that place, there is security, there is stability, there is a future and a hope. G.K. Chesterton said this. He said, we do not want, as the newspapers say, a church that will move with the world. We want a church that will move the world. I want to just invite us right now, for anybody who's here in this place, and maybe you're going, I don't even know Jesus. I don't have this hope. I don't have this understanding of who he is. I want to invite you to say a prayer with me today. I want to invite you into a relationship with God. I want to invite you into a relationship with Jesus that is secure, that is lifelong, that is everlasting, that never ceases, that never desists, that doesn't stop no matter what's going on in the world. He is always there for you, and He has plans for you, plans to prosper you, to give you a hope and a future. And I want to invite you today, if maybe you're here in this place, while every head is bowed and every eye is closed here in this house, if you go, Pastor Andrew, yeah, I want to enter into a relationship with God. Maybe you're watching online today or you're up in Neil and you go, today is my day. I need to enter into a relationship with Jesus. I need to start becoming a disciple. I want to enter into those benefits that you've talked about today. I want to ask you just to do something brave and bold, and that's just slip up your hand and I'll see it and you can put it down. So if there's anybody here today, you watching here in the room or online, just, yeah, I see that hand, you can put it down. Is there anybody else here today who will say, Pastor Andrew, I want to become a Christian today. I want to become a Christ follower. I want to become a part of the church. Yes, I see that hand. You can put it down. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So good. People here are getting right with God today. Come on, church. We're gonna do two things. We're going to pray. I'm going to ask the team if they want to come, the rest of the team. To know Jesus is to have hope. Not just hope that things are going to be okay. It's an eternal hope, a future secured. Why don't we pray this prayer together? Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I ask you today to come into my heart and give me a brand new start. I'm sorry for all of my sin. And today, I lay it down at the foot of your cross. I acknowledge that you died for my sin. And on the third day, you rose again to give me victory. I believe that I am now a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Come on, why don't we give a clap for everybody who's making a decision today. It's awesome. If you did that, if you prayed that prayer, I would love to invite you to come and see our team right out the doors. Just on the way out, we have a Bible we'd love to give you. We would love to be able to bless you with that. Thank you, Jaden. That is super helpful. Fantastic. It simply looks like this for everyone who was wondering. It's the Bible. And we're going to give that to you. We'd love to have it upside down again. I've got it. All right. So you can see our team straight after that, but I'd love to be able to meet you and pray with you. I've asked our team to do something here, and I want us all to stand. There's one final benefit that I didn't talk about before, and I want us all to focus just for a moment. We've got time. If we're in a hurry for something, we need to go, well, what's the priority? Do we want God to speak and move, or do we want to just get this over and done with? That's the question. The final benefit here is this thing that we like to call the Holy Spirit. This is the benefit of being in the church, is the benefit of having the Holy Spirit. So the early church was birthed through the power of the Holy Spirit. It was sustained by His comforting and spurred on by His enabling. This is what the Holy Spirit does. And the Holy Spirit, Oswald Chambers said, the Holy Spirit cannot be located as a guest in a house. He's not just welcome here. This is His. The church is the Holy Spirit's. He owns it. He doesn't just come into it. He owns it and He breathes in it. And we are wanting Him all the time. I've got to tell you this morning, we're singing this song, Fresh Wind. And we need a fresh wind of the Holy Spirit in our community. I don't know about you, but sometimes it seems like it's getting darker outside and we need the power of the Holy Spirit like we have never before to be able to discern what's happening, to be able to step into a new thing in God, to be able to lead with boldness, people to know Jesus. We need the power and the enabling of the Holy Spirit to be able to live out a Christian life. We can't do this without Him. We can't just not do it alone. We need one another. We need Jesus. We need the Holy Spirit in our lives. And I'm praying today that we get a fresh wind, a fresh touch, a fresh anointing of God when we come to Him. How desperate are we? I mean, seriously. I'm going to be really frank. How desperate are we to see a move of God? I know there's a handful that are, but are we desperate to see God move in our city? Because a move of God is going to change everything. A move of God in this city will turn it upside down. It will blow it inside out, and it will cause more problems than you've ever seen before. Are we desperate to see it? There's going to be problems. There's going to be conflict. There's going to be different stuff that happens. There's going to be different tensions. There's going to be things that rise up, because I tell you, when God's moving and God's breathing, things don't necessarily go well. It's not all smooth sailing. What do we actually really want? Do we want the kind of revival that says, oh, well, God's just going to make everything all rosy and good? No, no. When we get into revival, it's going to come with challenge. And I want to be really clear about that. What do we want, church? Do we want a comfortable Christianity, or do we want to see something that is profitable for our community? We need a profitable Christianity. So what are we going to sing? I'm going to close the service. We're going to sing. I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing over you. And we're going to get into God's presence just for a moment. But let's get desperate for Him. Let's get desperate for Him. All right. As we do, as our tradition, once you stretch forward your hands, I'm going to pray a prayer of blessing. Then the team are going to lead us out. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace. God bless you, Harvest Church. Come on, let's get into this. Let's sing. Let's sing together.